Thank you. Thanks for the introduction, Claudia. So since the discovery of the Ebola virus almost 50 years ago, there's been about 30 documented outbreaks, or a little over 30 outbreaks, with human cases. And while the incidence of the disease on a global level is pretty low, with less than about 40,000 cases that have been confirmed over time, the case fatality rate remains devastatingly high, and it's usually over 50% in the outbreaks that we see, so 50% more, one out of two people die when they get Ebola. And it also affects families, social networks, and caregivers, and healthcare workers. And so it's really a disease that devastates communities. And we see that outbreaks of the disease tend to cause significant disruption to provision of basic healthcare provision, as well as far-reaching social and economic damage to the countries that it affects. The WHO has declared two outbreaks of Ebola, so the one in West Africa that started in 2013 and lasted until 2016, and it's crazy that's 10 years ago now, and the 10th Ebola outbreak in the Democratic Republic of Congo that was from 2018 to 2020, public health emergencies of international concern, and the WHO has listed Ebola on their list of priority diseases for research and development in emergency contexts, as well as the list of diseases that pose the greatest public health risk due to epidemic potential and or lack of sufficient countermeasures. But another thing that we note, if you look at the epidemiology of Ebola, is over the last 50 years, the first 40 years of the outbreaks that we saw were mostly in remote, isolated, rural settings, and they were small. And the last two big outbreaks happened in the last 10 years, and they were the two biggest outbreaks we saw. They were in urban settings, they affected mobile, and highly densely populated areas. So despite advances in surveillance, diagnostic, and case management over the last 10 years, mortality rates from Ebola still remain high. Sun Tzu tells us in The Art of War to know thy enemy. So in order to fight an outbreak, we need to better understand it. However, Ebola virus disease outbreaks are thankfully uncommon events. But this very uncommonness limits the opportunity to study the disease in real time, because you can't study therapeutics or vaccines without patients. So during the 10th epidemic in the eastern part of the Democratic Republic of Congo, outbreak response teams and researchers were able to do just that, to study and advance the science around the disease in order to learn how best to fight against it. The outbreak in DRC allowed research to trial and eventually license two specific treatments for Ebola, as well as develop a large clinical database of patients, plus epidemiological data that was standardized, harmonized, and compiled in a way that it had never been done before. And our presenters are going to talk a little bit about that. It was also the first epidemic of Ebola where vaccines were able to be used outside of a vaccine trial and at scale. So the vaccine that we use against Ebola is usually used in what's called a ring strategy, and that's where we vaccinate contacts and contacts of contacts, as well as healthcare workers, but contacts and contacts of contacts of index cases. This strategy has been proven effective at reducing the severity of disease in those who are already infected, as well as reducing the spread of Ebola during an outbreak. Yet there's a paucity, there's a scarcity of data and studies on Ebola vaccines. There's a landmark vaccine trial that was done in 2015 called Sasufi that gave us efficacy data. But since then, we haven't learned a lot more about these vaccines and how to use them. So both of the studies presented today can help advance our understanding of Ebola vaccination and knowledge and add to the knowledge base around how best to use vaccines in real-world applications. And I'm going to switch quickly to French. Et je vais passer la parole au professeur Steve Aouka, que j'ai rencontré en...
And I would like to give the floor to Steve Aouka. Now, it reminds me of the year 2019-2020. There were so many of you who at the time were in Goma to fight against one the largest Ebola epidemic. So John gave you a summary, but I would like to say that we are going to have two very interesting presentations on EVD, and more particularly on the effectiveness of vaccination. But I would like to shed some light on the way the data that will be presented to you were collected. Difficult conditions, I'd say, because of armed conflict in the area and also some reluctance and hostility in the community, the weakness of healthcare system, and also scientific distrust and mistrust. How can you collect data and perform research on a disease that is considered to be a conspiracy against the Congolese people? However, the teams seize the opportunity of an Ebola epidemic, which unfortunately, I have to say, an opportunity that we must seize for research purposes, and more particularly when the data, which is so crucial and so scarce, can help us once properly processed to better manage the next epidemic, as Charles Nicolle was saying. These new diseases are bound to happen. So I'm going to give the floor now to Sophie Mekin for the first presentation. Sophie Mekin is an epidemiologist with a background in statistical and mathematical modeling of infectious diseases. Since joining Epicentre in 2023, she's worked on several research projects evaluating the impact of vaccination and other interventions on outbreaks of Ebola, cholera, and malaria. And it's in DRC. This is what really matters.
Thank you for the introduction. Okay. As John and Steve have both said, the RVSV ZBOV single-dose vaccine is currently the only vaccine recommended for reactive use during Ebola outbreaks. And the 2018 to 2020 EBD Ebola virus disease outbreak in the DRC is the second largest outbreak ever reported, with over 3,000 cases and over 2,000 deaths, and the 10th outbreak in the DRC. And importantly, it was also the first widespread use of the vaccine outside of a controlled trial setting. So previous studies suggest that the vaccination with the RVSV vaccine confers perfect or near perfect protection against Ebola virus disease. During the phase 3 cluster randomized ring vaccination trial, the Ebola SASAFI trial in Guinea and Sierra Leone, efficacy was estimated to be 100%. And preliminary estimates from the 10th outbreak in the DRC estimated effectiveness to be 98%, but this was only based on data until March 2019, so after about 6 months. As both of the moderators have said, given the limited evidence, there's a clear need for more up-to-date estimates of the real-world effectiveness of the vaccine. And so the aim of this study was to estimate the effectiveness of the RVSV vaccine against Ebola virus disease using data collected during the 2018 to 2020 outbreak in the DRC. So how did we do this? So we used a test negative study design, which is an observational study based on suspected EVD cases who sought healthcare at an Ebola treatment center during the outbreak. A little bit about how the test negative design works. So in the general population, there will be some people who are vaccinated and some unvaccinated. And some of these will at some point go to Ebola treatment centers. And those who meet the criteria to be a suspected case are tested. And then vaccine effectiveness is estimated from the odds ratio of being vaccinated among the test positive individuals, so the cases, and the test negative, the controls. So obviously the data that we used for this is the data that was collected at these Ebola treatment centers, which was individual level data that includes, among a huge amount of other information, three key variables. So the first was obviously individuals' infection status, so either positive or negative, confirmed by PCR. The second was information about their vaccination history, so their vaccination status, whether vaccinated or unvaccinated, and the vaccination date. And both of these were self-reported by individuals. And finally, there are a number of variables describing individuals' either known or possible exposure to Ebola in the 21 days before symptom onset. And this included things like whether they had contact with an Ebola case and other exposure risk factors. So before actually being able to estimate vaccine effectiveness from this data, there are a few additional steps that we took, and I will highlight some of the key parts of this now, so bear with me before we get to the results. So the first part, we determined which individuals were eligible to kind of include in our analysis according to four main criteria. So the first was that they had a known infection status, so it was not missing, so it was either known to be positive or negative. Second, that they had a known vaccination status, either vaccinated or unvaccinated. Third, that they had been eligible for vaccination, and this excluded, at least for part of the outbreak, pregnant and breastfeeding women and children under 6 months who were initially or children under 1 year, actually, who were initially ineligible for vaccination before a change in the vaccination protocol. And we also included individuals from August 2018, when the outbreak started, to November 2019. In total, this gave us just over 26,000 individuals who were eligible, of which 1,273 were positive for EBD. There was some missing data, and any missing data, especially the vaccination onset delays, were replaced with plausible values using a method called multivariate imputation. And this process was repeated multiple times, but shan't go into the details. Next, we tried to ensure the same level of EBD exposure between cases and controls, since it wasn't necessary that all individuals would have had sort of exposure to EBD before arriving at the health center. And so to do this, we restricted the analysis to individuals who, in the data, reported contact with an Ebola case. And this was reported by just over half of cases and 10% of controls. Next, we matched each case to one control on four variables, so sex, age group, their resident health zone, and month of symptom onset, and again repeated this process multiple times. And then finally, after all of this, we estimated effectiveness using multivariable logistic regression, adjusting for these four matching factors as fixed effects. And then kind of the combined result from this includes kind of all the uncertainty and variation that came through in the missing data and the matching process. Okay, so finally onto the results. So our main analysis was to estimate the effectiveness of vaccination against developing Ebola virus disease after 10 days. And so the main study population that we looked at comprised individuals who were either unvaccinated or vaccinated at least 10 days before symptom onset and reported this contact with an Ebola case. The study population then in the analysis contained on average 309 cases and 309 controls, as they were matched one-to-one. And we found, kind of just looking at the data itself, that vaccination at least 10 days before symptom onset was much less commonly reported among cases than controls. So on average, 5% of cases were reported as vaccinated compared to 21% of controls. Now, the exact proportion of cases and controls that are reported as vaccinated varied because of this kind of imputation of missing data and matching process. And the figure on the right shows the variation in this proportion for cases and controls. So now we present the effectiveness estimates. So we estimated that 10 days after vaccination, effectiveness against developing Ebola virus disease was 84%, with uncertainty between 70 and 92%. We found no clear difference in effectiveness according to within some subgroups, so according to sex, age, or after the change in vaccination protocol, which included some additional individuals like pregnant women, but also included a change in dose. Some of these subgroup analyses were, however, limited by sample size. For example, in children under five, there were very few individuals that were able to include. And this is reflected in, as you can see, the very wide uncertainty in some of these subgroup estimates. We found a very mild protective effect 3 to 9 days after vaccination, although due to, again, very wide uncertainty, this was compatible also with no effect. At least some of this uncertainty or variation in the effectiveness of the vaccine for this shorter delay could in part be attributed to differences in effectiveness between 3 and 9 days, although we really lacked the power to look at any smaller delay groups. We also carried out some sensitivity analyses to try and understand the possible impact of self-reporting of the key variables, which was individuals' vaccination history and these kind of either known or risk factors for EVD exposure. So first, we considered possible misreporting of vaccination status, which is quite complicated, but hypothetically, misreporting of this could lead to under or overestimates of effectiveness, depending on how common it was and for whom it occurred, although in general, the effect was very small. Second, we considered alternative definitions of exposure to Ebola, such as including other risk factors, such as attending funerals, or using other definitions like whether cases had been reported in either the individual's health area or health zone before symptom onset. And while each of these definitions have their own limitations, we did find that effectiveness was consistent under all of these different definitions we looked at, which shows that at least our estimates were not sensitive to the definition of EVD exposure that we used. So in summary, we found that vaccination with RVSV was highly protective against developing Ebola virus disease at least 10 days after vaccination. Although the point estimate was slightly lower than the efficacy from the trial in Guinea and Sierra Leone, our findings were consistent with these results, as well as with the expectation that effectiveness would be lower than efficacy. And although we found no clear difference in effectiveness by sex or age, further research is probably needed to understand efficacy in particularly vulnerable groups, such as pregnant women or young children, where we were limited by the number of individuals we could include. I think a strength of this study is that the observational kind of test negative design allows us to estimate effectiveness from data that already existed and was collected during the outbreak. And a kind of a big benefit of this is that it allows us to confirm the effectiveness of the vaccine while avoiding kind of some of the ethical challenges of carrying out confirmatory clinical trials. Most importantly, and importantly for future outbreaks, the results show that kind of high real-world effectiveness of the vaccine, and not only out of a kind of controlled trial setting, but also used in very challenging for the very challenging environment of the Eastern DRC. So, kind of overall, our findings add further evidence to support the reactive and targeted use of this vaccine during future Ebola outbreaks. So I'd like to say a big thank you to everyone who contributed to this research and also to the kind of huge number of people among partners who collected the data that made this study possible. Thanks.
Merci beaucoup, Sophie, pour cette présentation, cette belle présentation.
Thank you very much for this beautiful presentation. I'm now going to give you Rebecca Coolborn. I know her very well.
Alors, Rebecca est arrivée en RDC.
Rebecca came to the DRC in 2019 during the big Ebola outbreak. And at the time, We had just been declared as an international priority. So we changed the way we managed the epidemic at the time. And she was the national coordinator, and I was deployed as the field coordinator. And at the time, there were 15 Ebola cases per day, with 29 health zones impacted in three provinces, the north, Kivu, Ituri, and south Kivu. And we had a whole array of partners who all came with the best intentions. And so we had to identify those who actually came to help and those who came to help themselves. And Rebecca was one of those who actually came to help.
Elle est titulaire d'un master en santé publique.
She owns a master of public health in epidemiology with a focus on international and global health from the University of Michigan in the US and a bachelor of science in biology from Texas Christian University. Before joining her current employer, Epicentre, in 2015, she worked as a field epidemiologist with Doctors Without Borders, Médecins Sans Frontières, in many countries, and she also volunteered for the U.S. Peace Corps in Burkina Faso. Rebecca also coordinates clinical research at the University of Michigan in order to advance the understanding of the causes of health inequalities and interventions and policies to overcome disparities.
En outre,
furthermore, as a component of her work at the Tarrant County Public Health Department, she facilitated community partnerships leading to the establishment of the first four-county collaborative medical reserve corps in the U.S. to surge capacity emergency preparedness.
Au cours des 10 dernières
In the last 10 years, Rebecca has been deployed to the field more than 10 times as an MSF epidemiology coordinator for the emergency Ebola response in Guinea, in the Democratic Republic of Congo, and Uganda. And I must add that it's partly thanks to her clear-sightedness that these studies for which we collected data more than 5 years ago, came to see the light of day and are still being used and valorized and valued. Rebecca, you have the floor.
Merci vraiment, Professor Steve, for cette introduction.
Thank you so much for those kind words.
Good afternoon, everyone. So today I will present on the case fatality risk among individuals vaccinated with the RVSV vaccine. As my colleague Sophie just discussed, the RVSV vaccine was highly effective at lowering the risk of Ebola virus disease during the 10th EVD epidemic in the Democratic Republic of the Congo. Though 84% effectiveness at preventing EVD means that some vaccinated people will still get sick. This underscores the importance of describing the vaccine's effectiveness against severe disease and death, which is what I will discuss in this presentation. For the first and second objectives of our analysis, we consider the time between vaccination or lack thereof and symptom onset according to vaccination status. And I will discuss how we define vaccination status later in the presentation. The first objective is to assess the case fatality risk, that is the number of EVD positive deaths divided by the total number of EVD positive patients according to vaccination status. The second objective is to assess cycle threshold values at admission according to vaccination status. And cycle threshold is an indication of disease severity. And for the third objective, we consider the time between vaccination and administration of EVD-specific treatment to explore any positive or negative interaction between the vaccine and treatment. So our analysis is a retrospective cohort analysis using the same data source as my colleague Sophie, that is the compiled line list from Ebola health facilities. However, unlike Sophie's analysis, we included only EBD-positive patients. We also looked at the entire duration of the 10th Ebola epidemic in the DRC. So now let's review how we define vaccination status. Recall that the incubation period of EBD is 2 to 21 days. Accordingly, we know that people who were vaccinated 21 days or more before their symptom onset were vaccinated before their EBD exposure. This is our first vaccination status category. And likewise, we know that people who were vaccinated 2 days or fewer before their symptom onset were vaccinated after their EBD exposure. However, defining the next vaccination status categories is a bit trickier. However, we know that antibody protection occurs 10 days after vaccination, and that other research has used the same cutoff when considering vaccination status categories. As such, we considered those vaccinated 10 days or more before symptom onset to have probably been vaccinated before EBD exposure. And those vaccinated 3 to 9 days before symptom onset were classified as probably vaccinated after EBD exposure. So let's next consider our statistical analysis. We calculated the case fatality risk and its 95% binomial confidence interval among patients with confirmed EBD by vaccination status, comparing case fatality risk using two-sided Fisher's exact testing, cycle threshold values for nucleoprotein at admission according to vaccination status were compared using Wilcoxon rank sum testing. Stratified exploratory analyses were performed to calculate the case fatality risk according to the EBD-specific treatment received and the time from symptom onset to admission at an Ebola health facility. To explore the effect of vaccination on EBD-related mortality, we used Poisson regression models with robust error variance. Now let's look at the outcome of our first objective, case fatality risk according to vaccination status. So in this table, we present the case fatality risk and crude risk difference by vaccination status. Let's start by focusing on the first two rows of data in the table. Among the patients who were vaccinated, the case fatality risk, among those who were not vaccinated, rather important, the case fatality risk was 56.2%. This is in sharp contrast to the patients who were vaccinated, considering any time from vaccination to symptom onset. The vaccinated patients had a case fatality risk of 25.1% compared to those who were not vaccinated, meaning that those who were vaccinated had half the risk of death. Now let's consider the timing of vaccination, looking at the additional rows of data in the table. We see that compared to unvaccinated patients, the earlier a patient was vaccinated prior to their symptom onset, the lower their case fatality risk, dropping to as low as 17.5%. Importantly, vaccination even only 2 days or fewer prior to symptom onset after EBD exposure, when a patient was already infected and incubating the virus, resulted in a case fatality risk of 27.3%. This is still less than half that of the unvaccinated patients in our cohort, and to our knowledge, lower than case fatality risks reported in all previous literature and outbreaks. This means that vaccination, even when administered late, is still beneficial for reducing the risk of death. Now let's look at the adjusted analyses. In this analysis, all estimates were adjusted for risk factors for death from EBD that had been identified in previous studies or by an expert in the field, including age group, sex, healthcare worker status, time from symptom onset to admission, and EBD-specific treatment. We see here that those vaccinated 2 days or fewer before symptom onset had an adjusted risk ratio of 0.56. The lower the relative risk, the higher the protective effect. Those vaccinated 3 to 9 days before symptom onset had an adjusted risk ratio of 0.44. And those vaccinated 10 days or more before symptom onset had an adjusted risk ratio of 0.40. Overall, we see that even after adjusting for all risk factors, for example, whether you arrive early or late, whether you receive EBD-specific treatment or not, vaccination significantly decreased the risk of death for EBD-positive patients compared with not being vaccinated. So now let's look at our second objective, cycle threshold values at admission according to vaccination status. We assessed cycle threshold values for nucleoprotein at admission. We present here the median cycle threshold values and their interquartile ranges. Cycle threshold values were significantly higher, indicating lower Ebola viral load among those vaccinated 21 days or more before symptom onset, with a median value of 30 cycles, than among patients who were not vaccinated, who had a median value of 21.4 cycles. Cycle threshold values were also significantly higher, indicating lower viral load among those vaccinated 10 days or more before symptom onset than patients who were not vaccinated. And compared to the two previous groups, late vaccination had less of an effect on viral load, but still resulted in a lower viral load than not being vaccinated. In summary, cycle threshold values were statistically significantly higher, indicating lower Ebola viral load among all vaccinated patients compared to the unvaccinated. These findings on cycle threshold values at admission may explain, in part, the vaccine's ability to reduce the risk of death. Finally, let's look at our third objective, potential interactions between the vaccine and treatment. Monoclonal antibodies, the most effective EBD-specific treatment, greatly reduce the risk of EBD death in EBD-positive patients. As we have discussed in this presentation, the RVSV vaccine reduces the risk of EBD death in EBD-positive patients. There is the possibility of including monoclonal antibodies and the RVSV vaccine as components of post-exposure prophylaxis. Of note, the RVSV vaccine and monoclonal antibodies both share the same viral target, the envelope glycoprotein on the Ebola virus. Given this, if the vaccine and monoclonal antibodies were to be given at the same time or close together, it is not yet known if there would be an antagonistic effect. We looked at indications for this in our study. Let's look at what we found. So while in our study, the vaccine and EBD-specific treatments were not administered simultaneously, we were able to explore potential interactions when the vaccine is administered 4 days or fewer before starting treatment, as well as when no vaccine is given before starting treatment. Adjusted risk ratios were calculated taking into account age, time between symptom onset and admission, and EBD-specific treatment. A risk ratio above one is considered antagonistic, meaning there would be evidence of a negative interaction between the vaccine and monoclonal antibodies, while a risk ratio below one is considered non-antagonistic, meaning no negative interaction between the vaccine and monoclonal antibodies is observed. So compared with those who were treated but not vaccinated, those who were vaccinated and treated with Regeneron or MAB114 had an adjusted risk ratio of 0.29. Those who were vaccinated and treated with ZMAP or remdesivir had an adjusted risk ratio of 0.73. And those who were vaccinated and treated with an EBD-specific treatment had an adjusted risk ratio of 0.68. Although the results are not statistically significant, probably due to the small sample size, since all of these point estimates fall below one, we can conclude that we do not observe an antagonistic effect. In conclusion, vaccination with RVSV greatly reduced the risk of death, even when adjusted for EBD-specific treatment, age group, sex, healthcare worker status, and time from symptom onset to admission. An additional observation explains the possible effect of RVSV on the reduction of the case fatality risk. Patients with EBD who were vaccinated showed higher cycle threshold values at admission, signifying lower viral load compared with patients who were not vaccinated. This difference increased as the time between vaccination and symptom onset increased. Furthermore, our results suggest no antagonistic effect between the vaccine and monoclonal antibody treatment, even when administered within a short interval. It is important to vaccinate as early as possible to reduce the risk of infection, as shown by my colleague, Sophie. But even late vaccination reduces the risk of severe complications of EBD, including death. Vaccination is better late than never. Our results highlight the possibility of using the vaccine as post-exposure prophylaxis. Importantly, as some EBV-positive patients who were vaccinated still died, the vaccine should be considered as post-exposure prophylaxis in combination with EBV-specific treatments. And I would like to acknowledge all partners, collaborators, and patients for their contribution to this research. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, Rebecca. Thank you, Sophie. I think the value of these studies is really that it adds to what we know about Ebola vaccines and their use in real-world settings. Like I said in the introduction, we don't have a lot of information on these vaccines, and so it's good to have real-world data that shows us, okay, we know that the efficacy trial showed 100% efficacy, but what does it look like in a real outbreak in real time? What's the effectiveness of this vaccine? And that's what Sophie's presentation showed us. And then Rebecca showed us that even though it's only 84% effective, which is very good, there's still a good effect for people that develop Ebola anyway. Because of the way we use this vaccine, a lot of people will develop Ebola because they're vaccinated after they have been infected. And so that's an extra added value. So that's going to hopefully help us in future outbreaks make better decisions and target the right people for vaccination. Are there any questions in the room? And who has the tablet? You got it? Okay, great. Okay. Okay. Emmanuel. Or no.
You.
Bonsoir.
Bonsoir.
Good afternoon. Thank you for these very interesting presentations about vaccination. I'm Antelme from Dakar. I was wondering, the vaccine in itself, is it as efficient with the Sudan strain?
Merci.
Professor?
Professor?
Sinon, je peux... Does anyone respond?
Or I can answer that. Actually, the glycoprotein, which is targeted in the vaccine that we use,
d'Ebola, ce n'est pas le même.
Is not the same as the species, the Sudan species. But if you remember, in Uganda there was an epidemic in 2022. And they sent vaccines to be tested during the epidemic, and it was the first time in the story of Ebola epidemics that we had vaccines that were available soon enough to be tested. So, as I said, we need to test the vaccines soon enough to have information and evidence that the vaccines are efficient or not. So we sent vaccines on the field, and one of those vaccines that was sent was almost the same that the one that is used against other species. But with a glycoprotein that is used in the South Sudan vaccine, but there's no indication that this vaccine would also be protective against any other Ebola species. Thank you. Many thanks to the speakers and to the facilitators. I would like to get back to the last part of Rebecca's presentation. She mentioned the interactions. Recently, we've had those new tools, vaccines, specific drugs. We just saw that there could be, that there might be some interactions. So what lessons can we draw from that? With MSP and INRB, we now need to turn this into a strategy with a decentralized model in a timely response in order to decrease the caseload. Thank you.
Oui, Manu, c'est toujours opérationnel.
Well, with you, it's always operational, right?
Voilà. So, d'abord, ce sont des très bonnes
first of all,
pour les futures épidémies.
This is very valuable information for the future epidemics. We have a vaccine which is effective, even if vaccinated late people will have, if you wish, less severe forms of the disease. Then we have molecules which we have tested also, which are good. And now in terms of strategy, of course, we have to take into account the availability. And for the moment, as I said yesterday, an outbreak gives us the possibility to validate tools. But now these tools need to be
actionable wherever we need them. For the moment, what we do in terms of response for EVD, we have a vaccine which is used as the first line of treatment to respond as soon as we have confirmation of the species, like in Zaire, and the molecules are then used for the proven cases. So basically, we treat patients. We do a ring around the cases, and then we treat the patients. We decrease the viral load, and then we do the ring. And then we suppose that we have controlled the five epidemics that have taken place after the big crisis. But the main problem is supply. If we have a good strategy for any outbreak, but there's no supply, well, then this is going to be the zero multiplier. So this is where we need to think about that. And I'm happy that MSF still continues to think about what will be the best strategy in terms of availability so that we can actually face any outbreak in the future. Do we have more questions? Yes. Good afternoon. Marie Jaspar from Alima. Hi, Rebecca. Hi, Steve. I'm a little bit more reserved than you are on your conclusion when you say that there is no interaction between the vaccine and the treatment. I think that what comes out of what you presented is that you can have the vaccine and then treatment. It does not decrease the efficacy of treatment, but people die less, which is very good because that's what we want. But jumping to the conclusion that there's no interaction, well, I think we shouldn't be doing that because we cannot be sure that the treatment will not inhibit the vaccine. Are we still sure that the vaccine still works despite the treatment? I just want to bring in this caveat. And also, we're very happy that the vaccine decreases mortality, but I think we should remember that vaccines are also supposed to decrease the infection and the number of cases. We must remember this because the vaccines are mostly there to avoid contamination. I think we need to bear this in mind. It's not really a question, but more of a comment. Thank you and congratulations on those two very beautiful presentations, very beautiful talks. Thank you.
Bonjour.
Good afternoon.
Bruno.
I'm Bruno. I'm a student.
Alors, lors de la vaccination
and
contre
during
HIV,
the
à la 10e
vaccination
for
EVD during the 10th outbreak, I was wondering if you have observed efficiency variations on account of sex or age or any other demographic factor. And if yes, why do you think there were such variations?
Thank you for the question. So when we were looking at the effectiveness of the vaccine against the disease, we looked in a few analyses at whether there was any difference in effectiveness by sex and age group. So for sex, well, for both, we didn't find any clear evidence of a difference. The point estimates for effectiveness in young children were slightly lower than for adults, but this was quite limited by the number of individuals that we were able to include in those groups. So as I said, I think in the overall study, there were on average 309 case and control, so of all ages. When we just looked at children under 5 years old, for example, there were only on average 21 children that could be included. So it was difficult to make any kind of strong conclusions about effectiveness differences, but the results that we did have, we didn't find any differences between these.
Yes, question for Rebecca. Thank you, Rebecca, for the presentation. A comment and a question regarding the CT value, because you have some data on the CT value. You show that you have a strong link between the vaccination delay and the CT value. One. But you did not adjust for CT value in your model. Did you try to look at that relationship? Could CT value, so viral load, could be on the pathway or it could be a confounding factor? Do you have some comment on that?
I'm going to let Etienne respond to that since he adjusted.
Je vais répondre en français, Jean-François.
And I'll answer in French.
La question, c'est que justement, on n'a pas ajusté.
The thing is that we did not adjust exactly because what you're saying, because it's in the causal pathway. So we just we see that the vaccine has an impact on the CT value. We wanted to try to see if the vaccine could protect from deaths, among other effects, through a decrease in the viral load. So this is why we did not adjust for CT value, because we think it's on the causal pathway. Mathieu, can you confirm that? Because we conducted the statistical analysis together. So can you confirm that this is right? Does this answer your question? Yes, we can discuss that later. Thank you. Thank you, Etienne. Thank you. It's more or less along the same lines. For those who, I'm not sure I understand, for those who were vaccinated within 2 days before diagnosis, did you actually exclude those people who had received monoclonal antibodies? No, right? You just adjusted for that. And in that population, how many people did you have who were only vaccinated and how many who were vaccinated plus monoclonal antibodies? Because this brings us back to the previous question or questions. Do you measure the effect of monoclonal antibodies or the effect of the vaccine? And also one last comment for Uganda. You said that we deployed the vaccine, faster, but if I remember well, it arrived 72 days after the outbreak, and there were fewer cases. Well, that's something else, right? But in order to answer your question,
l'interaction possible, l'effet antagoniste qu'on pouvait avoir.
The antagonistic effect that we could have. We had 4 days between the closest. We took all those who had the vaccine plus treatment at 4 days and those who had only received the treatment to see if there was an antagonistic effect. Now, about the effect of treatment plus vaccination, we carried out several analyses. There was a stratified analysis per type of treatment and then an adjusted analysis per treatment. And then all the analyses showed that the effect is vaccine independent. Well, there's an effect whether or not there's a treatment. The vaccine has an effect whether or not there is a treatment. Does that answer your question? Reducing the viral load, well, that's something else. The viral load is measured before the treatment, pre-treatment. It's the viral load upon admission that we showed you here.
Bonjour, Pierre-Henri Mourigny de Grenoble.
Pierre-Henri Mourigny from Grenoble. Antifibrinolytics. Natric acid is part of the package recommended by WHO against Ebola. Did you use it? Did you look into it? Did you take that into account in your analysis? Antifibrinolytic, acting on coagulation. It seems to me it's part of the WHO package. Well, it depends on the clinical situation. I don't think it's used systematically. Less than 40% of our patients in our study had blood loss.
Oui, alors moi c'est très basique, hein.
My question is very basic. If I get it right, this vaccine, even when the vaccine is administered 10 days earlier, you have 17% of lethality, even in those who were vaccinated in due time, right? Let's take things in order. What Catherine showed is that 84% of the people taking the vaccine will not develop the disease. It protects 84%. Some people will have the disease despite the vaccine, and among those, nevertheless, the fact of having been given the patient divides by two their risk of dying. As any vaccine, it's not completely effective, but it's very efficacious still.
Sophie,
as Catherine, Sophie, sorry, I get their names wrong. So that's what Sophie confirmed, what we had seen. The vaccine is really efficacious to reduce the disease. And what we didn't know is that at least at 85% in this study, we assume 15% are not improved, but their mortality is reduced by the vaccine. And the subgroups who got the vaccine still developed the disease but were treated nevertheless, there was no death in that group. That's very important. I hope it's clear.
Okay, I think we are finished. Thank you very much for your attention.